Bharatha. Rishabha was supposed to be an incarnation of God. He was born as the great grandson of Priyavrata, brother of Uttanapada. Rishabha had 100 sons. The eldest was called Bharatha. Bharatha married Panchajani and had 5 sons. He ruled over the country for a very long time, got disgusted with it, handed over the same to his sons and reached the ashrama of Pulaha on the banks of the river Gandaki. He was such a righteous, noble and generous emperor that the country over which he reigned is called after him as Bharat. As a recluse, he began to worship Lord Vishnu with earnestness. His sole refuge was the Lord. He had controlled the body, senses, and mind. He left off all actions and fruits of actions. He considered everything to be the dispensation of the Lord and obeyed the dictum, Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Vraja. Even while worshipping, he would forget his body and its work. He was fully immersed in the joy of thinking of the Lord. He made deep meditation on the sacred Gayatri Mantra with its full significance as that light which is other than that visible one, which appears as the sun god, which is great among all the devas, which destroys all karma pala, which has by mere thought created all this universe, and which as the inner controller protects the jiva who seeks its protection with the light of consciousness, that light which is always propelling our intellect, we beseech and propitiate. One evening, when Bharatha was standing in the river offering water oblations to the setting sun, a fully pregnant deer came to the edge of the water for a drink. At the very same time, very far from there, a lion roared. It's usual for lions and tigers to do so before and after they approach a water source for a drink. Hearing the lion's roar, the timid deer jumped off the water to the other shore, fell down and died due to both to exhaustion and fear. While it was jumping, its young one dropped from its body into the water. The sage saw the fate of the deer and of the young one, took pity on the young deer and presumed that God had disposed that he should protect the young deer. And so he took it to his ashrama and reared it. He became very fond of it and would not leave sight of it lest some wild animals should devour it. Gradually, his attachment for it became so intense that he slowly forgot his austerities. Even while performing austerities, his mind and eyes were on the young deer. He used to keep it in his lap while meditating, worshipping, eating, or sleeping. Soon, the time came for him to leave his body, but he could not take his mind off from the deer, and so he was soon born as a deer nearby. Bharatha, though born as a deer, could, by the merit of his previous samskaras, remember his past life. He felt very sad for his slip in having developed attachment to a petty creature and decided to avoid all company. As a deer, he used to roam all alone near about the ashrama of sages, would not molest anybody, and would be satisfied by eating dry leaves or grass, whatever he could come across. Soon he left off that body and was born as the son of a learned Brahmin. That Brahmin of Angira Gotri was learned in all of the Vedas and rituals, the Sat and the Asat, and was pure and sattvic, generous and kind. He gave the boy good education, taught him the Vedas, and performed his Upanayanam, by which time death snatched him away. The boy, though he could remember his previous births and was endowed with knowledge and wisdom, obediently learnt all that his father taught him, but lived like an idiot, insane and stupid. He was deaf and dumb to all insults and abuses, with his mind firmly fixed on the feet of the Lord, lest he should slip again and fall into the mire of samsara. His father and mother both died. He had 9 stepbrothers who took him to be a stupid fellow and made him work like a bull. He used to obey their commands or those of anybody implicitly, used to take food that anybody gave him without any distinction, or beg or even starve. He used to roam about with tattered clothes and slept anywhere he could. He never cared to take bath or keep the body clean. One night, when he was lying under a tree while keeping watch over a cornfield, some thieves came that way in search of a runaway. Their master, the chief dacoit, was to offer a human head to the goddess Kali in her temple. They had secured a rustic for that purpose, and when they were engaged otherwise, the rustic made good his escape, knowing the danger ahead. The thieves were after him but could not find him. When they found Bharatha with a well-formed body, they took him to be a stupid man and so a good substitute. They picked him up, tied him with ropes and took him to the Kali temple. He was bathed, dressed, decorated, fed well, and with garlands round his neck was made to stand and bend before the deity. The chief dacoit came there fully drunk, with a big, fearful sword, singing and dancing to offer the human sacrifice to goddess Kali. Bharatha took no notice of all these, stood calm and quiet. Goddess Kali, seeing the divine brilliance on the face of Bharatha, decided to put a stop to the unholy crime that was about to be committed, came out of the sanctum sanctorum with ferocious eyes and uplifted hands, snatched the sword from the hands of the dacoit and beheaded him and his followers, untied the bonds of Bharatha and set him free. One day, Rahugana, a king of Sindh, was proceeding in a palanquin to meet sage Kapila for getting initiated into the knowledge of the self. When he came to the banks of the river Ikshumati, one of the 4 bearers of his palanquin fell ill and a 4th man was searched for. The bearers found Bharatha lying under a tree to be a fit person for the 4th place. He was young, robust and sturdy. Without any compunction, they dragged him and gave the 4th place to carry the palanquin. Bharatha, without a protest, started carrying the load, but was unmindful of his own body or the palanquin which it carried. The king was upset as the vehicle did not move steadily and reproached the bearers. The old bearers pleaded that the new bearer was not doing his duty carefully and so the loss of balance in the palanquin. The king reproached the new bearer ironically that if he was tired already or old or weak, he would be properly taught a lesson to behave better and to obey the commands of his master. Bharatha, the new bearer, calmly continued the journey but told the king that what he, the king, remarked was the truth. Young, old, tired, etc. belonged to the body as its attributes. He was not caring for the movements of the body, much less of the palanquin. And if he was to be taught a lesson, he did not know first who was to be the teacher and who the taught, for he was quite unconcerned with both of them. Then what benefit would the king derive by teaching him who was a lunatic? It would all be a waste. So saying, he continued his work with a smile but no remonstrance. Struck by this sharp reply, the king peeped out and found a Brahmin with the divine lustre as the 4th bearer. It was a crime. He jumped out of the palanquin and prostrated at the Brahmin's feet and begged forgiveness. All his pride vanished in a moment. The king inquired of Bharatha, "Who are you? You are moving about incognito. You seem to be a Brahmin, an Avadhuta. Are you Sri Dattatreya? Are you sage Kapila himself, of whom I am in search? I cannot brook disrespect to Brahmins. You are appearing like a dunce, but you are full of wisdom. Your words are replete with self-knowledge. So kindly teach me true knowledge and grace me with your kind looks so that I may be redeemed of the sin of showing disrespect towards great souls like you. Bharata replied, ignorant as you are, you show off as very wise to talk of teacher and the taught, for in the realm of the self, the difference does not exist. Vedas, extolling the heavenly bliss out of sacrifices, have not spoken the last word about the truth. He who cannot relinquish all actions after hearing the Upanishads, Vedanta, also cannot know it. The mind with its three gunas is the cause for all attachments and consequent bondage, arrogance, etc. So first the mind must be subdued. It hides you from the all-pervading, all-perfect, self-effulgent, infinite truth. It is the work of Maya. Shake off this Maya, I am the body concept, by which Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Mada, Matsarya are eliminated. They are the enemies preventing you from knowing the true nature of yourself. The king felt jubilant on hearing these words and prayed that a doubt of his may be cleared. You said the inquiry of the actions and effects, though apparent, are only relative but not absolute truth. So its inquiry cannot lead to the discovery of the truth. What do you mean by it? Bharata replied, you see the earth below, over it a modification of the same earth in the form of a body with the name and form of Bharata is standing. Over the shoulders of four such modifications of the earth, another modification of the earth is sitting with the name of Raja of Sin. With all your kingly pride, you are making the other modifications of earth to serve you for nothing. And thereby you are showing that you have no soft heart for fellow beings. As such, you have no place in the assembly of the learned. Yet you call yourself great, a king, and you want wisdom. When all the mobile living creatures are only modifications of the earth, what virtue is there in you to call yourself as greater than the other? Earth means all the five elements. This is all the work of Maya and time factor, the three gunas, the Prakriti and Karma, action. But consciousness is pure absolute, one. It has no inside and outside. It's all perfect, immutable. It's called Bhagavan, Vasudeva or Narayana, etc. You cannot know it by ruling kingdoms, reading scriptures, by feeding or performing one's duties, and by Vaidika ceremonies or by doing worship or by any other means, except by bathing in the dust of the feet of realized souls and by satsang. By constant shravana, the seeker's mind gets pure, desires dissolve away, and he merges with Lord Vasudeva. I was myself a great emperor by name Bharata in my previous birth. I became an ascetic and recluse and worshipped Lord Vasudeva very ardently. But due to the fault of attachment, I was born as a deer. With the help of my past memory, I was able to cast off that body and I am now born as a Brahmin. Having completely severed all my connections with the world by the sword of detachment, I am now roaming about incognito. This samsara is a big bazaar, where the merchant is looted by the dacoits called Kama, Krodha, etc. It's like a forest where the senses are the jackals which eat man while yet he is alive. There are mosquitoes called wicked men who bite the householder merely for their own benefit. There are bugs as men who steal away others' money. Men craves for even mean food and destroys relations and friends for the sake of kingdom, feels happy in the samsara, but even there he complains of thorns and pinpricks. Bearing all the stings of mosquitoes and snakes, he quarrels for petty profits and others' property, gets disappointed and dishonored, but he does not find the road for liberation anywhere nearby. Therefore, get rid of the feeling of the I am the body or I am the king, which is all the outcome of Maya. Cultivate evenness of mind towards all living creatures. Control your senses and mind. Thus, clear the bushes on the path of liberation with the sharp sword of discrimination and reach the goal. Having heard such wise counsel from the mouth of an exalted sage like Bharatha, the king of sin returned to his kingdom free from all his pride and became a man of wisdom and paved his own way smooth for liberation. Bharatha, having renounced his attachment to wife, children, kingdom, and all other earthly possessions, was able to see the Supreme Lord in every manifestation of life and was saluting Vasudeva in every visible form. By his conviction and mature wisdom, Bharatha was able to reach the state of birthlessness and merged in the Supreme. Parikshit inquired of Shuka the possible methods by which men may escape the tortures of Naraka, hell. Sage Shuka replied that the following are some of the methods by which man can try to avoid confronting the servants of Yama, the lord of death, by performing tapas, observing celibacy, by giving charities, by controlling the mind and the sense organs, by doing japa or namasmarana, by observing truthfulness, by undertaking austerities, by having devotion to God and one's own guru or teacher, by serving the devotees of the Lord, by knowledge of the scriptures, inquiry. And finally, the servants of Lord Death are afraid of approaching those whose mind is constantly remembering the Lord Supreme, Vasudeva. He explained this by narrating the parable of Ajamila.